Double honors to the true leaders of the nation of Israel. Peace and salutations to all the sensei Akim, enduring afflictions, making the calling and election sure. Shalom.
Shalom. Matthew 5:43. Ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy.
Khan, all right, this is in Matthew the 5th chapter, all right, Yahweh Shai, all right, he's speaking to particular Israelites, okay, saying, all right, particular things in the law, and he's reiterating things in the law, all right?
You got it. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you.
God, right? Because this is in this whole chapter, right? If you went up, all right, he said, all right, you have to have righteousness that exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. All right? We're telling our people, the Israelites, to repent before it's too late, you know? And one thing he's saying, all right, he's saying to love our enemies, all right? Do good to them, all right, who persecute you, all right?
Ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven, for he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good.
God, so that's a part of being the prince of the power, Yasha Allah, all right? The word Israel, all right, in the Hebrew, Yasha Allah, which means prince of the power, all right? So to truly be, all right, children of the highest, all right, this is something that we have to do, all right? We have to be as our Father is, man, you know? You can read that part against Salaki.
His sun to rise on the evil, Salaki. Your Father, so you can be, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven, for he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust.
That's right, all right? So the sun is going to shine on the evil and on the good, man. That's why Yahusha said to let our light shine, all right? So we want to do the same thing, man. Let our light shine, all right? Not only, all right, to our people, all right? Not only to the people who we camping with, our camps, all right, congregations, all right? This isn't no gang affiliations or anything like that, man, all right? You got particular camps that, I mean, we see that the poisonous nature of when you're just looking at, all right, your camp, and you're only doing good to them, but everybody else, you know, you're saying screw them, you know? That's not the way of Yahweh, Yahweh Shai.
For if ye love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans the same?
The publicans do the same, man. You know, Jake in the world do the same thing, man. You know, linking up with your clique, man. You know, you're only doing good to people who you trust, who you know, all right? You know, so to speak, right? And you're not doing good to people who you know, all right? They ain't gonna do nothing for you, you know? That's something that people in the world, all right, would do. That's why we're telling our people to repent, coming out of those ways of the world, all right? So that way we could be children of the highest. You got it.
It's Mark chapter 9 and verse 38. And John answered him, saying, Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and he followed not us. And we forbade him, because he followed not us.
That's right. You know, you got particular men, all right, who's doing this thing that's not particularly, all right, within this, who you know, all right? But he what did he say? He can read
it one time. God. It says, this Mark chapter 9 and verse 38. And John answered him, saying, Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name.
In thy name. So he's doing work in thy name. All right, talking about you who the world calls Christ, Yahweh Shai. All right, but what?
And he followed not us. And we forbade him because he followed not us. But Yahweh Shai said, forbid him not. For there is no man which shall do a miracle in my name that can lightly speak evil of me.
Mm-hmm. You know? So he's saying, forbid him not, man. You know, forbid him not, all right? Because he's doing the work, not just he's by himself, all right? It was one man, you know? He said one, you know? So it was one person that's doing the work by themselves, you know? but he's not within the group. You know what I'm saying? Hey man, this is according to Yahweh Shah, man. Who's more on that one?
Yeah. It says, "For he that is not against us is on our part."
That's right. You know, so coming in that lot, all right, being part of the body of Yahweh Shah, all right, it isn't a thing that you could just feel and put your hands on, man. All right, it's a spirit that you gotta walk in, man. All right, it's a spiritual thing that links this body together, man. You know, so just because, all right, you got someone, all right, across the whole four winds of the earth, the elect are gonna be scattered. All right, so you got someone, all right, in a city, all right, he's doing his own thing, all right, he's still part of the body, you know. And little do you know, he could be visiting, right, and you don't even know, you know, you don't even know who he is, all right, but he could be a true father of Mashiach, you know, even if he doesn't even know about Yahweh Shah yet, that could be his predetermined lot, you know. That's why we need to do good, all right, to even our enemies, so to speak, man.
Back in Matthew. Now, back in Matthew 5 and 44, 45, 46. Matthew 5 and 46, "For if ye love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? And if ye salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans so? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect."
That's right. All right. That really sums up the whole chapter, man. He's telling us, all right, to come in a lot of being the children of the highest, man. Prince of the power, all right, Yasha Allah, all right, being a true Israelite, man. You know, the scripture says not all Israel is of Israel. That's not even a breakdown, all right, but to be a true children of the highest, all right, you have to walk in a certain manner, man. You know, people in the world, all right, do particular things, man. Edomites show love, all right, to people who they know, who they're cool with, man. So you don't get no reward for doing something that everybody else is doing, you know.
This Hebrews, it's lucky. This Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 2, "Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares."
Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, man. You know, if you ain't saluting your brethren, all right, people who you familiar with, all right, then hey, man, you could be missing out on an opportunity, man, all right, to get blessed from an angel, man, you know. You don't want to be, super carnal when you're looking at somebody and you're just already writing them off, you know? That's not being an Israelite, man. That's not being Yasha Allah, right? That's not being a prince of the power, man. Children of the highest, you know? You have to let brotherly love continue like the first verse goes into, man. All right? You can't be just looking at somebody, all right, on face value, man, you know? Just because of their continence, you know?
It says, "Remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity as being yourselves also in the body."
You know? So we want to have a certain spirit on us, man, who are willing, man. You know, put on as the elect, man. We want to be compassionate, man. We want to look on particular people, all right? And we want to, you see? You know? This is a spiritual demon saying, you know? You're willing, all right? You'll come off of it. You know, regardless of what nationality he is, man. You know, if he's a heathen, then he has a certain lot, you know, but we can't just be looking at him like, oh yeah, that's a demon, may the Most High destroy that demon. Hey man, you know, even demons have a particular lot, man. You know, they're actually doing a bid for the elect, you know, they're doing a bid for the elect, you know, all things work to the good for those who love the Most High, all right, whose name is Yahweh, all right, you know, these other nations, hey man.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. You know, all these other nations, all right, they're gonna get with the program. They're gonna serve our power, man. You know, so even if they're not an Israelite, all right, hey man, you can say do good to all men. You know, do good. good to all men, you know, because ultimately, all right, the Most High, he's in perfect control, man, all right? Truly understanding the Most High is in perfect control. That's part of being the children of the Most High power, man, you know? We want to give, all right, these heathens every opportunity, all right, to repent, you know? So that way, when judgment day comes, then there's nothing that anybody can say. There's nothing that anybody can say, man, all right? Because these Edomites, they're going to go head first into captivity, as it was written, you know? But within that, all right, we want to do our part, man. We want to be the children of the highest, man. All right, love our enemies. You got it.
Back in Romans 11 and 28, as concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes. But as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes.
God, all right, that's one thing, knowing that we're Israelites, all right, we're princes of the power. All right, we know that there's enemies in this thing, man. All right, we're behind enemy lines. We're fighting a spiritual war, right, against principalities, right, spiritual wickedness in high places, you know. But within that, all right, hey, man, ultimately, we have to get to you.
As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes.
Right, so they're beloved for the Father's sakes, all right, and this is specifically talking about particular Israelites. You know, they're enemies for the gospel's sakes, right? But they're actually beloved, you know? You got it.
Yeah. Romans 11 and 29, for the gifts and calling of the Most High are without repentance. For as ye in times past have not believed Yahweh, yet have now obtained mercy through their unbelief.
That's right, you know? So the gifts, you know, particular things, the promises that were given to the Israelites, all right, it's irrevocable, man. All right, Most High, he, all right, according to the scriptures, all right, he made a promise, and he's a man of his word, you know? So regardless, all right, of where a particular Israelite stands in this thing, all right, if they're going to be least in the kingdom, all right, hey, man, that's the point, man. What's going on, bro?
We're
just preaching the gospel.
Yeah.
You believe in the Bible?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you have any friends? Do you love your friends? Okay, it answers your question. Because Yahusha, who walked towards Christ, he said to our friends, so to speak, you know? We're supposed to be loving our neighbor as well, you know? It goes even further to love our enemies, you know? Would you say you love your enemy?
I try to, yeah.
You try to, right. You know, because at the end of the day, we're in the flesh. You know, it's a fleshly battle. You know, it's a fleshly battle. Are you a Christian?
Okay.
Who's that?
What is it? Ephesians 6?
Ephesians 6? Okay. Yeah, spiritual battle. I just quoted that.
Yep.
But I was speaking about the flesh and the spirit, you know, because it's a camera in the way.
That's fine.
Yeah. You know? But, you know, there's a battle between the flesh and the spirit. So in the flesh, right, you could have particular feelings about somebody, right? But just as the world calls Christ, whose name is Yahweh Shai, you know, he actually told us to be good to those who persecuted, just like Christ, he actually went through, you know? You know the story, you know? He went through a whole lot, you know? And he actually prayed for those people who persecuted him, you know? He said, what did he say? You probably know the saying. It's my mind right now. He said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. You know? He said, Father, forgive them. And he was talking about those people who was, like, crucifying. You know? So we got to do the same thing if you want to really be a true follower of Christ, you know?
This is Galatians 5 and 17. For the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would.
Mm-hmm. That's right. You know? So the flesh lusts against the spirit. It's a war that we have to fight our flesh. You know, the flesh, you know, we might look at somebody with an evil eye. Israelites, part of the curses is that we're going to be looking at our brothers with an evil eye, you know? But ultimately, you know, we got to fight that flesh, you know? We got to walk in the spirit, you know? Because that's the only way the kingdom is going to be established, you know? Understand that we're in the end times? What's your belief?
Yeah. It's interesting to say. I mean, it's hard to know, but we don't really know the time.
Matthew chapter 24,
Matthew 24:3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end and of the end of the world?
So the disciples was asking, you know, inquiring about the end.
Verse, jumping down to verse 6. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet.
Right, so Christ, he was describing things that would be happening at the end. You know, wars, rumors of wars. What we see right now, there's a lot of rumors of wars, you know, which has been happening, you know, forever, but right now, it's like, really, I mean, the doomsday clock, they said, is at, what was it, 120 seconds or something like that? I don't know if you're familiar, but it's basically like a high alert. Like, I believe it was last year, you know, when they said that, I mean, World War III has been the trending topic, you know what I'm saying? Type of war, the type of arms, it's a big threat, you know? The type of nukes that have been created, which the scriptures actually prophesy about those missiles, you know? So we know through the spirit, our particular things that was talked about thousands of years ago, it's actually going to happen really soon, you know?
Yeah. It says, for nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places.
Mm-hmm. So you see that. Famines, all right? There's a lot of food shortages, you know, crops dying out, particular things happening, which we see the plague going on right now. You know, you got a face mask on. This is all a sign of the times right here, you know? And it said earthquakes in diverse places. If you go on Google, you can type in earthquakes in the last 24 hours, you're going to see a whole lot of earthquakes, you know? And it's going to be in particular areas where it's like, usually, it's unusual, you know? You got it.
Let's see. All these are the beginning of sorrows.
Beginning of sorrows, you know? So we're at that beginning of sorrows point right now, you know? We're at a time where you probably heard about the Great Tribulation, you know? Where the scriptures talk about Jacob's trouble, you know? Because Jacob, all right, he was the son of Isaac, he was the son of Abraham. So we're telling our people, the Israelites, which you can prepare to be an Israelite in spirit, but we're telling our people to repent because the kingdom of heaven is at hand, you know? Hey man, that's our imitating life. You know what I'm saying? We're telling our people the end is near, you know? So within that, you know, it's a certain thing that is prophesied about our people waking up, you know, about us coming back to our power. Like, you know what repenting means?
Yeah,
it's change your mindset.
Change your mindset.
I know in the Hebrew it's a certain word, you know, but okay, that's good. So so what does it mean to sin? Close short for the glory, that's good.
Metaneo for the word repent. Okay. It goes into change one's mind. To change one's mind for better. Heartily to amend with abhorrence of one's past sins. Mm. In Strong's definition, it goes into reconsider or morally feel compunction.
Yeah. Okay, good. So, yeah. That was good. No. What's the second one that says about sins?
To change one's mind for better, heartily to amend with abhorrence of one's past sins.
Mm-hmm. Abhorrence of one's past sins.
This is 1 John 3, verse 4. Whosoever committed sin transgresseth also the law, for the sin is the transgression of the law.
Right, so according to the scripture, sin is transgression of the law. You know what the law is? Go to the Bible, man. You're on point, man. That's right. Because a lot of Christians, they would just say, oh, the Ten Commandments, or they would even say the Two Commandments that Christ said to love the Lord with all our heart and our mind and soul, to love our neighbor as ourselves. But, I mean, the law, I mean, that's the first five books. It's really 613. It's about the commandments that was given, you know, talking to the Israelites. So, breaking one of those commandments, by definition, that's sin. Okay. Yeah, breaking those commandments, all right, that's sin. So particular things that was written in there, like adultery, murder, you know what I'm saying? Eating unclean foods, pork chop, crab, lobster, you know, idolatry, you know, honoring our mother and our father, you know? Of course, loving our neighbor as ourselves, that's like, between those two, really sums up all the law. It's really the law, it's really going into doing good to our people, you know? If you're having sex with anybody's wife, that's not doing good to anybody, you know what I'm saying? If someone is homosexual, according to the Bible, that's against the law. You know, that's not doing good to the world. That doesn't bring forth life, you know what I'm saying? So by definition, that's something that we need to repent from, you know what I'm saying? We need to actually turn back from that life of sin and turn back to the Most High.
Yeah, I actually got some friends that, like, they are same-sex attracted.
But they're what?
They are, like, attracted to the same sex.
Uh-huh.
But they, like, choose to follow Jesus and not, like, mad about that. It's like, really powerful to see. It's like, only trans.
So, you say they repented from it? Like, they are, like, okay.
Like, some of them used to live a gay life.
Right.
They're all gay.
To Christ, he said that there's really just one sin, you know, that's unforgivable, you know? You know that isn't just, you
know. It's an interesting context, I think, of unforgivable.
Homosexuality wasn't on there, you know? That was the point.
It's 1 Timothy 1:9, knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and for sinners, for unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for whoremongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind, for manstealers, for liars, for perjured persons, and if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine.
Every law, there would be no reason for the law. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, that's part of understanding that, you know, the law was made, right, for us to actually look at and be like, okay, we need to actually not do that. You know what I'm saying? Because going back to what we said before, the flesh and the spirit. In the flesh, it might be particular things, you know, that we would probably want to do. You know what I'm saying? But it's not about just, you get that Jeremiah 17:9. And it's not just about what we're thinking is right and wrong. A lot of people, they look at sin as just something that's wrong. You know what I'm saying? But what does the scripture say is sin, you know?
This is Jeremiah 17:9. It says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?
The heart is desperately wicked and it's deceitful above all things, you know? So we could be thinking something, but the heart, the Hebrew is alive, you know, which means your mind, you know, it's deceitful of all things, you know, and desperately wicked. It's desperately wicked, you know what I'm saying? So that's why we have to be aware, you know what I'm saying, of our heart and our mind. You get Proverbs 3:5, you know, and we got to ultimately repent, you know, we have to go back to the scriptures. Say what? Exactly, you know, we have to really let the Most High, you know what I'm saying, take care of it, you know. How we do that is by referencing our thoughts, you know, with the scripture say. You know, we can't just look at, oh, you know, I feel this. Nah, man, what does the scripture say? You know?
That's even the temptation that the serpent had in the garden. It's like, hey, God says this, but this is what you feel. What feels right to you. You don't feel naturally.
Right. That's right. Yep. Revelation 20 talks about that old serpent. You know, he's back today. You know, the spirit of that old serpent is here. Doing the same thing, you know, basically marketing what we would say, you know, about the beast, the mark of the beast.
Not too much.
All right, we can touch on that real quick. You know, well, we believe the mark of the beast to be a physical mark, which you know about the RFID microchip. Okay, see, that's probably the problem. You say everybody knows about it. You know what I'm saying? But we was, basically.
Elon Musk.
That sounds like somebody would come up with, but
yeah, you gotta look into it.
relationship interfacing, you know, it's just trying to merge man with computer, basically.
Revelations 13 and 12, and he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he make a fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth, that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. And that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name.
G4742, which is stigma, a mark pricked in or branded upon the body. To ancient Oriental usage, slaves and soldiers bore the name or the stamp of their master or commander branded or pricked, cut into their bodies to indicate what master or general they belonged to. And there were even some devotees who stamped themselves in this way with the token of their gods.
Talking about this thing right here, you know? But we see
that's another sign, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I think most of what Revelation is talking about happened. Like, it was just
okay.
Stuff that,
oh, so you believe that everything kind of happened. What's the term? Preterist. You're a preterist? Everything kind of ended around like 70 AD. Everything kind of like the prophecy ended around that time.
Like most of it was like, hey, this is about to happen. This is going to happen
in my lifetime. So right now, would you say that we're like in the kingdom?
I think it's cool when God damn people hearts, you know, we get like little area of the kingdom right here. That's kind of cool.
That's cool manifestation.
Yeah.
That's good.
I think that's
fine. That's fine. I mean, I agree that, you know, the end, we've been in the end really technically since, you know, after Christ died, you know what I'm saying? So we've been at the end for a long time.
Yeah, all that stuff talking about here. Yeah.
Oh, they're running Romans?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've
kind of heard that before. Okay.
This is a book of Matthew 6 in verse 19. It says, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. Jumping down to verse 24, it says, no man can serve two masters, for either will hate the one and love the other, else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve the Most High and Mammon.
So we're taking that mark of the beast, we would say the archetype microchip, you know, that's basically a token that you put in that stamp on, showing that you serve the beast, you don't serve the Most High power. You know, so that's why it's important. You have to make a decision. You have to choose one, you know? You can't serve both, you know? So, yeah, you got it.
It's Leviticus chapter 19 and verse 28. Ye shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any parts marks upon you. I am the Lord, Yahweh Hashem, Yahweh Shah. Jumping down to Leviticus 21 and 5. They shall not make baldness upon their head, neither shall they shave off the corner of their beard, nor make any cutting in their flesh.
Right, yeah, so he's making is cutting in the flesh, quote-unquote natural, but you actually shaving, you're actually marring the corners of your beard and shaving, that's against the law. You know, that's breaking the commandment that we was given, you know?
Why do you think I gave that commandment?
Well, you know, Most High God, he real particular, you know what I'm saying, like certain things, like he real particular, you know what I'm saying? Just like with beards, you know what I'm saying? Like that's a badge of manly dignity, you know what I'm saying? So in the Most High's mind, that's what makes you a man, you know, having that hoary, that, you know, that hoariness, if that's the right word, that roughness, you know what I'm saying? That's what associates with a male or a man. You know, so it's certain things that associate with the overall landscape of his creations, and that's why he, you know, made it like that. You know, and you can't separate the dirt from the mind of the Most High. You know, whatever, however you want it to be, that's just what it is, because it say his thoughts are not our thoughts. So a lot of things is kind of above our strength to really figure out, you know.
Yeah. You start doing stuff like that, it becomes perverse. You know what I'm saying? Making crazy designs, you know what I'm saying? Like stuff like that. Like, he's with things as it should be, just natural. You know what I'm saying? Just trying to change things around. And, you know what I'm saying? But of course, it's confusion. You know, like Babylon, that means confusion.
This Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse 28. Lo, this only have I found, that God have made man upright, but they have sought out many inventions.
That's right. You know, many inventions, man. You know, like we, this goes on. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of inventions that's not necessarily unlawful. You know, we could drive a car, you know? I mean, that's an invention. You know, but certain things that was invented, right, to be contrary, our time, this how has things set up, that's where we're actually, you know, transgressing. You know, and that's what goes back into what we're going into. Being aware, you know what I'm saying, of our mind and our flesh, and not like trying to do something outside of it, you know?
Yeah. Okay, so it sounds like we agree on a lot of stuff. It sounds like you have a lot of, you know, talking points ready to go. What is, like, the main message y'all want to get across with this?
Just repentance.
Yeah.
Telling people to repent.
Ultimately, part of coming with repentance is separating from this current world in the way it's set up. Like we was reading in Revelation the 13th chapter about the beast. You know, and this actually represents the beast system. You know, America, or you know, just the overall landscape of this whole world and like how they live. It's contrary to the Heavenly Father, His laws, His commandments. So within that, we're telling our people, which are the Israelites, which can beat anybody on this board, or even you, like the brother said, because it's not determined by the outward appearance. You know, it's determined by your spirit. Like it say, none of the wicked shall understand. You know, so a righteous man can recollect with these things, and they can be like, okay, separate from it. You know, but ultimately, we're telling our people who are the Israelites who have an opportunity at salvation to separate themselves from the ways of this world. Come into the ways of our Lord in the world called Jesus Christ so that they can have salvation because we're coming to the end. We're in the end times right now. We believe that we don't know exactly what day, but we believe it's going to come soon. So we don't have much time left to, you know, keep dibbling and dabbling in the ways of this world, because if you continue in the ways of this current world, you're going to perish. Like, this America's completely, like, the Most High God is against America. He's not with nothing that America stands for. Like, Joe Biden being put into office, vaccinations, you know, these different laws and penal codes. You know, they're children being able to change their sex, their genitals. Like the Heavenly Father, he's not with those type of things. That's why he brought forth judgments on Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, flooded the earth out. You know, because of wickedness. You know, because of things that are contrary unto him, and he's going to do an ultimate mighty work right here on the earth in the same manner. So we're telling our people, like, step away from this current world and the things of this world so you don't have to perish with this world, you know?
I think he kind of wants to get to the bottom of the fact that how we make a difference in the actual church. We're standing out here and people go to the churches too. It's like, what's the difference between him coming here and getting information and going into a church and information, you know? Is that kind of what you were trying to get at? Like, what?
Yeah, I think the church.
I don't want to leave any stones unturned. You know what I'm saying? This is Romans 12:2. It says, "If ye not conformed to this world, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of the Almighty." Revelation 18 in verse 5, "For her sins have reached unto heaven, and the Most High have remembered her iniquities." This is Revelation 18 and 4, "And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, that you receive not of her plagues.
It come out of her, my people, that you be not partaker of her plagues partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. You know, because like we was telling you, America, it's got a horrible judgment that's gonna come to this place. Like a lot of people, they don't really see it, you know, but the Heavenly Father's gonna bring forth like something serious, very the day of the Lord. You know, the scriptures speak about it. It's gonna be dreadful. Woe unto you who desire the day of the Lord. For what end is it for you? You know, there's gonna be a lot of people that's gonna perish here in America, you know, because of you gotta come out of her, like depart from these philosophies, the ways of this place, so that you don't partake in the judgment that comes for you, you know? Just like he was telling you about the cutters in the place. Don't get no vaccination. Like I told my mother not to get it. She talking about getting it. You know, Lord willing, she obtained mercy. You know? If you're gonna do it, if you can't do something like not poke yourself with a vaccination, which obviously got a lot of components in it that's not meant to be in your body, then you know, I don't know how you got a lot to worry about, you know.
This is Revelation 11 and 8. It says, "And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified."
I got
to
run
y'all,
but
there's
a book I don't know if it's where you're open for the video, but.
No, you good?
I'm definitely a Gentile convert, so.
I think you got a good shot, though.
Good chance.
That's right, man. Hey, man. You know, it's like in the kingdom, hey, man. Gentile converts, man. Edomites, they're going to be holding church. Not to say he's an Edomite. I'm just saying, in the kingdom, that's what they're going to be doing. They're going to have their church. You know what I'm saying? They're going to serve our power. Right? His name is Yahweh. You know? It's Isaiah 62, verse 6. I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace day nor night. Ye that make mention of the Lord, Yahweh, keep not silence, and give him no rest until he make Jerusalem a praise in the earth. He was asking, you know, the reason why we're here, hey man, preaching the gospel. Like Yahweh said, preach the gospel. You know, he said, ultimately, the gospel shall be preached, and then it shall come. You know, which, you know, I'm not sure his understanding. He thinks all the prophecies came to pass already. That opens up a lot. You know what I'm saying?
So he in the church, so.
He in the church.
That's his first mistake,
that's
right?
First mistake. You know what I'm saying? He has a point?
Yeah, corrupt. Yeah, just want to finish up a point.
Yeah.
I kind of brought Revelation 11 and 8 out.
Okay.
And then it kind of like shifted. But the reason I brought it out for a specific purpose, because the brother had made a point. He went to Revelation,
Revelation 18 and 14.
So I was going to make the point that, you know, this place, because he was talking about America, how America was going to be destroyed. So I wanted to go here and then show the gentleman how this place is spiritually Sodom and Egypt, you know, because of the things that goes on. It's, you know, I was going to explain how it's bondage here and how it was, you know, had that spiritual transgender, you know, that spiritual wickedness that Sodom possessed. You know what I mean? And I was going to convey that to the brother. Spirit kind of shit. This is the book of Revelation 11 and verse 8. It says, "And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city." And when it's talking about those dead bodies there, it's actually talking about our people, because we've wandered out of the way of understanding. You know, so we're in the congregation of the dead. Those of us that are, you know, don't know who we are. You know, it says the ox knows his master's crib, but his people does not, they don't consider. It says, which spiritually is called Sodom, and I just expressed the fact that it's a spiritual Sodom because of the debauchery, because of the gender bender activity, because of
the vaccinations,
the same sex on same sex marriages.
5G.
5G.
Genetically modified food.
So it's just
bestiality.
There's all kinds of nonsense that just runs rampant in this place. And it goes on to say, in Egypt, and the reason they call it Egypt is because the scripture actually defines what Egypt is. It's a place of bondage. You know, so Egypt is actually a house of bondage. And this is a house of bondage to the children of Israel. And it says, where also our Lord was crucified. And how was he crucified? He was crucified. His persona was completely crucified. You know, what he stands for, that was completely crucified in this place. He was made to be someone that he isn't at all. Not only him, but also the angels and the prophets and the scriptures. You know,
I just wanted to touch on that.
Matthew chapter 11, verse 12. And from the days of John the Baptist unto now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force.
That's right. You know, Yahusha also said the kingdom is within us. You know, speaking to, all right, the followers of the Mashiach. You know, Yahusha. You know, and that's the same kingdom, all right, that suffers violence. You know? So, hey, man, you can receive it, man. This is the end times. We're not in the kingdom as of yet. Not every single prophecy came to pass, right? But most of them came to pass, you know? It's really just the mark of the beast, right? We got World War III upon us, right?
You know, the ultimate prophecy of 144,000 men and one-third men, women and children coming into the spirit of our Lord, Yahusha Mashiach, the spirit of prophecy.
Right. Yep.
That's the ultimate prophecy.
That's the ultimate prophecy. That new covenant, man, bringing forth the kingdom, man. You know, we're not here. We're not in the kingdom. You know, certain things have to happen first. You know, so yeah, I know.
It's Daniel, chapter 9 and verse 12, and he have confirmed his words, which he spake against us and against our judges, that judged us by bringing upon us a great evil. For under the whole heaven have not been done as have been done upon Jerusalem. Chapter 9 and verse 12, and ye have confirmed his words which he spake against us and against our judges that judged us by bringing upon us a great evil. For under the whole heaven have not been done as have been done upon Jerusalem. This is another prophecy that's ultimately being filled out right now, man. We've had the punishment of our iniquity has been accomplished against us, man. We've been through several captivities, man. We're ultimately in the belly of the beast. It says, I shall bring thee very low among the heathen. It's no lower than we're at right now, man. This is worst case scenario, man. This is worst case scenario right here. The iniquity abounded to the point where the love of many is waxing cold. You know, where our own people are killing each other more than our enemy is, you know, or to the level that our enemy is. We're enemies with each other. You know, we already got all these other nations against us, but we're enemies of ourselves, man. You know, that's the ultimate thing that has been confirmed, man. All right, is that we have a ultimate evil has been happening to us like no one ever has been through, you know, and it has never been like this, you know. That's another prophecy that's been fulfilled, man. Our people being brought down to this horrible, horrendous stage, man. You know, suffering to this point, you know.
Out here.
Baruch, chapter 2, and verse 30. For I knew that they would not hear me because it is a stiff-necked people, but in the land of their captivities, they shall remember themselves.
Yep. So this is a prophecy, right, that we see playing out right now. You know, this is a prophecy that that was playing out right in the times of slavery now. You know, not to the degree where we're at. You know, we could be said Nat Turner, all right, started to read the Bible and he started to see that, hold up, you know. But right now, all right, we're yet to stay in our captivity. We're actually, all right, coming into, all right, not only remembrance of ourselves, but we understand, all right, things in the scriptures, all right, that was written thousands of years ago. We're piecing them together. We've seen these things play out, you know? There's only a couple.
It's Revelations chapter 11 and verse 11. And after 3 days and a half, the spirit of life from Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shah entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them.
Yep. 3 days and a half, you know? Roughly about from 1619, all right, to about 1969, you know? 350 years, you know? Each day like into a year. We see, all right, ever since, you know, the 60s, all right, really, you know, before that, you got the commandment keepers, you know? You got Abba Bivens, you know, High Priest Abba Bivens, you know, he came, all right, and hey, man, you got the sign.
Malachi 4 and verse 6, 5, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Most High.
That's right. Yeah, Elijah the prophet, all right, through the Spirit, that's Abba Bivens, you know? You know, John the Baptist, all right, he came, all right, but that was 2,000 years ago, you know? But that great dreadful day, the Lord hasn't come yet, all right? So Elijah the prophet, all right, he came again as Abba Bivens, you know, bringing, all right, did you read it?
Verse 6, and he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, as I come and smite the earth with a curse.
Right. So this thing is all about repentance, man. Elijah the prophet, all right, he did it with particular works, all right? He matched up, all right, the Most High power, all right, with the God Baal, you know what I'm saying? And he caused, all right, our people to repent back then. You got John the Baptist, all right? He preached the baptism of repentance, all right? Now today, all right, we're telling our people to come back to the Most High power, man. This is before the great and dreadful day, man, all right? This is before the day that is darkness and not light, man. You know, the first verse talks about it's going to burn as an oven, all right? That's something that didn't happen yet, all right? There's wicked people still walking around. This scripture said that the wicked shall be stubble, all right? So we know that hasn't happened yet, all right? And that was in the Old Testament, you know? So this is another prophecy, all right, that we see playing out as we speak, you know?
It's Colossians chapter 1 and verse 26. Even the mystery which have been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints.
Before that, you know, they didn't know exactly what was going on, you know? Yahusha, he was talking about particular things, and it was like a dual prophecy, you know, like the brother, you know, he thought that all the prophecies happened already, you know, which a lot of things happened, all right, between, you know, 70 AD, you know what I'm saying? But a lot of things, you got the seven seals, seven trumpets, all right? Those things didn't play out yet, man, all right? Those things didn't play out until the last couple hundred years, man. You know, if even that, man, it's a lot.
This is Daniel 12 and 4. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased.
See that? Even to the time of the end. So particular things, all right, wasn't even made to be revealed, all right, until the time of the end. You know? And we see things being revealed now, man. You know? And that's why we're telling our people, all right, to repent, man. This is a calling, all right? This is something that was prophesied, all right? In Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter, man. All right? Coming to mind particular things, man. All right? The blessing and the curse, all right? We understand that we are cursed people. We understand that we're in this low state. You know, we're in the land of our captivities, remembering ourselves, you know? And within that, hey, man, now knowledge is being increased, you know? Now words are popping out the scriptures, all right? Not only prophecies, but particular revelations, all right? Things that was, all right, that was written, all right, for us, all right? Upon whom the ends of the world are come.
It's, Romans chapter 16 and verse 25. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Yahushua Mashiach, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting power, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith.
Right. And that goes back into what the brother asked. You know, why are we doing this? Why are we here? You know what I'm saying? This is all the reason. This thing was prophesied. Just us doing this alone is part of the prophecy. You know?
It's like every other time.
God. It's Romans chapter 16 and verse 25. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Yahushua Mashiach, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting power, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith.
This is something that is being played out, man. You know, as we speak, man, Lord will we be those men, all right, who are truly faithful, who's going to endure to the end, you know, to actually see all these things come to pass, you know. But until then, you know, we have to do what we have to do, you know. We have to actually, all right, embody the gospel, you know, live the gospel, all right, and of course, preach the gospel, all right. This is something that Yahushua said is going to be preached, you know, for a witness unto all nations, you know, Moabites, right, Elamites, Ishmaelites, you know. Hey, man, all nations, man, you know, because our people were scattered amongst all nations, you know? So that's one reason why this thing has to be preached, you know, to have our people wake up, man.
This is a 2 Peter 3 and 13. It says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. I was just going to say, you know, it says that according to the promise, we look for a new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. And we know that that's a promise that hasn't been fulfilled yet, because if you look around, this isn't a place wherein dwelleth righteousness. No. So you can't be a preterist. You have to somehow reconcile this scripture right here. You know, the promise and the prophecy says that it's going to be a new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. There's no righteousness here.
God, not. Goes back to what I was saying before, well, the scripture we read in Isaiah the 62nd chapter, you know, the watchmen not holding their peace until Jerusalem is being made a praise in the earth. Jerusalem's not being made a praise amongst the whole earth right now, man. You know? So we're not there yet, man. You know? That prophecy hasn't fully been completed, you know, Jerusalem being made a praise, man. Particular things that's why I asked them, are we in the kingdom? You know? You know?
This is Ephesians 4. It's Ephesians 4 and 13. It says, till we all come to in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of the Most High, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Mashiach. God, so we have to all come in, we have to come into the fullness of in the full measure of Mashiach. That's talking about the body of believing Israelites, man. You know, that hasn't happened yet, you know. We're still working on that, you know, and eventually that's going to come to its completion in the new covenant, when he puts the law, statutes, and commandments in our inward parts. You know what I mean?
This is 2 Ezra chapter 7, verse 43. says, but the day of doom shall be the end of this time and the beginning of the immortality for to come, wherein corruption is past, intemperance is at an end, infidelity is cut off, righteousness is grown, and truth is sprung up. Then shall no man be able to save him that is destroyed, nor to oppress him that hath gotten the victory. It says, 2 Ezra 7 and 43, it says, but the day of doom shall be the end of this time and the beginning of the immortality for to come.
So it says the day of doom shall be the end of this time. What is it talking about? It's talking about the end of an age. It's going to be the end of a rulership. You know, the end of one heavens and the setup of another heavens, a new heaven.
It says, wherein corruption is past, intemperance is at an end, infidelity is cut off, righteousness is grown, and truth is sprung up. Then shall no man be able to save him that is destroyed, nor to oppress him that have gotten the victory.
So it says, well, incorruption is past. You know, our beloved brother Paul, he talked about how this corruption has to put on incorruption. You know, you can read that verse in the second half.
It says, in the beginning of the immortality for to come, wherein corruption is past.
Yeah, incorruption will be past because death will be swallowed up. There will be no more death for the Israelites.
It says, intemperance is at an end, infidelity is cut off.
Yeah, intemperance is at an end. You know, that's not being able to control yourself, man. You know, you're not able to restrain yourself. That's going to be at an end. And it says infidelity is past. When someone is infidelity goes into not being faithful, you know, not being faithful to the Heavenly Father. Man.
It says righteousness is grown and truth is sprung up.
Yeah, it says righteousness is grown and truth is sprung up. That means that, doesn't the scripture talk about how you're not going to have to teach your neighbor, know the Lord? All will know him from the least to the greatest, you know?
Then shall no man be able to save him that is destroyed, nor to oppress him that hath gotten the victory.
Yeah, because you're not gonna, no one can deliver out of his hands. If the Most High wants to do something to you, no one can deliver you out of the hands of the Heavenly Father. And no one can oppress the one that got the victory. In the same token, the Most High, those who hide under the shadow of the Almighty, you know what I mean? You won't see any evil, man. You know what I mean?
It's Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 21. Thy people also shall be all righteous. They shall inherit the land forever, the branch of my planting, the work of my hands, that I may be glorified.
Mm-hmm. People will all be righteous, man. You know, I just touched on that, the fact that we're going to be, you know, we're going to have the law, statutes, and commandments on our inward parts. You know, he's going to make a new covenant with the house of Israel. You know, it's not a new covenant with the whole inhabitable earth, you know, is going to be with the Israelites, the world of Israel.
It's it. Verse 22. A little one shall become a thousand, and a small one a strong nation. I, the Lord, Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shai, will hasten it in his time.
Yeah, that's right. Because there's going to be certain men that the Most High is going to use to bring back the deceased of Israel.
Isaiah chapter 4 and verse 1. And in that day, seven women shall take hold of one man, saying, we will eat our own bread and wear our own apparel. Only let us be called by thy name to take away our reproach.
So that's going to be, you know, that's a prophecy that still has to be fulfilled, man. That's going to be women back in their natural order, you know what I mean? Not trying to usurp authority over a man, and they're going to be taking hold. And that seven doesn't mean this is going to be just seven women. It's going to be a complete number of women back in their rightful state, operating in, under the rulership of their man like they're supposed to, you know what I mean, in subjection and taking hold.
And that's a little one is going to become a strong nation, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah 45 and verse 25, it says, "And the Lord Yahweh shall all the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory." It says, "In the Lord Yahweh shall all the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory."
All right. You know, in the Lord shall all the seed of Israel be justified. All the seed of Israel is going to be justified because the scripture talks about who the Most High did foreknow. It says who the Most High did foreknow, he did justify. You know, he justified. And then ultimately, that's going to go to the whole house of Israel. You know, because like we touched on earlier, you know, we're going to be bringing back Israelites through our loins. You know, Lord, I don't want to write this out with those men.
It may be time. Ezekiel, I don't know.
This is Ezekiel chapter 11 and verse, I started 16. It says, Ezekiel chapter 11, verse 16. It says, "Therefore say, thus saith the Lord, Yahweh Bashim, Yahweh Shai, although I have cast them far off among the heathen, and although I have scattered them among the countries, yet will I be to them as a little sanctuary in the countries where they shall come."
God, so he will be a little sanctuary. That's because the Most High always has a remnant that he deals with. You know, so it's saying he'll be a little sanctuary to them. You know, and that's going to be that remnant of Israel. You know.
This is a prophecy that's happening too. You got remnants of men waking up throughout all countries throughout the earth. You know, that's a part of verse 17. "Therefore say, thus said the Lord, Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shai, I will even gather you from the people and assemble you out of the countries where ye have been scattered, and I will give you the land of Israel."
Mm-hmm. Yep, I'll gather you out of the places that's going into those remnants. You know, I'll gather you out of those places where you were driven, and I will, Salaki, read that one.
Okay. It says, and they shall come thither, Salaki. Verse 17, therefore thus said the Lord, Yahweh Hashem, Yahweh Shai, I will even gather you from the people and assemble you out of the countries where ye have been scattered, and I will give you the land of Israel.
Yep. So Most High is going to gather his people once again and set them in their land, like he promised to our fathers, you know.
"And they shall come thither, and they shall take away all the detestable things thereof, and all the abominations thereof from thence."
Yep. Because the Most High is going to, he's going to purge, you know, his people of all unrighteousness. You know what I mean? And they're going to be a righteous people unto him. You know?
"And I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within you. And I will take the stony heart out of their flesh, and will give them an heart of flesh."
Yep. It's that purging and pruning process. Ultimately, it's going to be, a complete renovation of your body. Give you a whole new body. The scriptures talk about that celestial body and terrestrial.
It says that they may walk in my statutes and keep my ordinances and do those
like. Because, you know, it's not going to be a doing away with the law. You know, there's not going to be a doing away with the law. It's only going to be, you keeping the law, you know. And it's going to be second nature. You're going to keep the law, and it's going to be second nature. You know, it's going to be effortless.
He says, "That they may walk in my statutes and keep my ordinances and do them, and they shall be my people, and I will be their power."
That's right, man. So we won't be, there won't be an instance where we're not, in good standing, you know, with the Heavenly Father, man. You know, we're not going to be estranged from the Heavenly Father. We're not going to be, bastards, you know, so to speak.
That is the new covenant, man. That's good news, man. You know, we're not going to be transgressing. You know, we don't have to.
here, you know what I'm saying? Telling our people to know the Lord, all right? Because all of us are going to know the Lord, right? You know? That's something that has not happened. You know? There's still churches, all right? Body believing Israelites out here doing this work, you know?
Jeremiah, chapter 31. Now this is Jeremiah 31 and 31. Behold, the days come, saith the Adonai, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers, in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was an husbandman unto them, saith the Adonai. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Most High. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their power, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more any man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, know the Most High. For they all shall know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Most High. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. So to touch on what the brother was saying, you know, we're not going to have to teach, you know, our people anymore. That's how you know that, you know, we're not in the kingdom yet. You know, because there's still people like us standing out here saying these things. Hell, there's still the Christian church open. You know, and they're still telling people to know the Lord.
Oh, shit, all these big-ass towers and buildings, man. You know what I'm saying? Yahweh Shemashah said they should build, but I would throw down. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yep. Shoot, we're about to be walking on concrete. You know?
So, yeah, scriptures talk about, you know, circumcising our heart. That's what it's talking about, man. Getting that new covenant in our heart. And not having that stony heart, like Ezekiel 11 goes into. You know what I'm saying? This is something that was given to the Israelites, like that scripture goes into Hebrews 8 and 8, reiterates the same thing, man. The kingdom of Judah, the house of Judah and Israel, you know, the northern and the southern kingdom. You know, so there's no such thing as being a spiritual Judite, you know what I'm saying? Or spiritual Israelite, you know, whether it's the northern kingdom tribe, you know? This is pursuant to the same people. It went into it, you know? The brother read the context. It says, not, you know, the covenant that I gave to their fathers. You know what I'm saying? And I took them out of the land of Egypt. So it's the same exact people, man. The Most High didn't change, man. And that's the good news, that we have something to look forward to. You know what I'm saying? Something that didn't happen as of yet, man. And we see it, man. It's like, this is 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 24. It says, then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to the Most High, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. It says, for he must reign till he have put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. This is a... This is 1 Corinthians 15 and 23. It says, but every man in his own order, the Mashiach, the first fruits. Afterward, they that are the Mashiachs at his coming. It says, then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to the Most High, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death.
Yep. So, you know, Lord Yahweh Shai, ultimately he's waiting on the precious fruit of the earth. And when he finally collects them, you know, those individuals are going to reign with Lord Yahweh Shai for 1,000 years. And what's going to happen? He's going to take all, according to Revelation, it talks about how he's going to take all rulerships and all dominions, all because it says he wore many crowns. That goes into having rulership. You know, and he's going to take that and he's going to put that under Yahweh. Because all things have to, you know, all things are subject to the will of the Heavenly Father. You know, all things are subject to his will. You know?
Yep. They said the last enemy to be destroyed is death, man. So it ain't going to be no more death, man. You know, that's the ultimate prophecy as well. Or for the Israelites, you know, which these scriptures is on the written, is written for Israel, man. You know?
Yep. Scripture says he made not sin.
Yep. Made not death. Yep. So the last enemy to be destroyed is death, you know, which ultimately goes into the flesh, you know?
Corruption.
Yeah, con. It's Jeremiah chapter 30 and verse 11. For I am with thee, said the Lord, Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shai, to save thee, though I make a full end of all nations, whether I have scattered thee, yet will I not make a full end of thee. But I will correct thee in measure, and will not leave thee altogether unpunished.
That's right, man. So Most High is going to bring that third part through the fire, right? You know what I'm saying? I won't leave you altogether unpunished. You know, the Heavenly Father won't leave us all unpunished, you know, because ultimately, you know, he's a just power, you know, so he's going to bring the third part through the fire. You know, he's a just power, so he chastens us day by day. You know, he chastens us so we're not condemned with the world, you know, because he's trying to develop moral character in us, you know what I mean? And ultimately, he's trying to make us righteous robots, which is the end result, you know, that rule in righteousness, you know, that profitable servant that's set up over the earth.
This is the book of the prophet Zephaniah 3 and 19. It says, behold, at that time I will undo all that afflict thee, and I will save her that halteth, and gather her that was driven out, and I will get them praise and fame in every land where they have been put to shame.
Give them praise and fame in every land where they have been put to shame. We haven't put to shame. You know, we've been through that initiation, humiliation ritual that the Heavenly Father puts everyone through that he receives as a son. You know, so we've been through that initiation ritual, humiliation ritual. And then after that comes, you know, being exalted. You be humiliated and then you're exalted. You know, and ultimately the kingdom comes. And along with the kingdom comes fame and praise.
It's James chapter 4 verse 6. It says, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he said, Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shai resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble.
Most High resists the proud, but he gives grace unto the humble. That's why he has to humble you. You know, scripture talks about humbling yourself in the sight of the Heavenly Father. You know, because those are the ones that are going to be resulted. Those are the ones that are going to be exalted. And that the meek are going to inherit the earth, like the scripture says. You know, it doesn't say the proud is going to inherit the earth.
Nah, brother, that's that humiliation process you was talking about. Mm-hmm. You know, because humble goes into humiliation. You know,
yep.
Which he has. He gives grace to the humble, man. So ultimately, we have to be humiliated to receive grace. You know? It's Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 6. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth.
Yep. So the Most High, he chastens you and he scourges you because he's trying to get the peaceable fruit of righteousness out of you. You know, so he's trying to turn men into pure gold. You know, the trying of your faith worketh a far greater treasure within you, you know, like the scripture says, roughly paraphrasing, not to butcher the scripts. It's a lucky how much you have shot.
Romans 8 and 20, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who have subjected the same in hope.
Yep. So the Most High, he does these types of things. He subjects you to vanity when you go into that word vent, you're in the blue letter.
Vanity in the Greek, Strong's G3153, Matitotis, Salaki. It says, what is the void of truth, inappropriateness, perverseness, depravity, frailty, want of vigor?
Yeah, you're depraved. You're morally deprived. You're morally depraved. You know what I mean? You know, you don't have morals. So that it says, if you read it from the top, I can tie it all in. I'll check.
Skip it?
Yes.
It says, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who have subjected the same in hope.
Yeah, so this was all being done.
Yeah.
So the Most High, he did this on purpose. He subject the creature to vanity. He morally, you know, made him morally depraved because he wanted to humble him. You know, it's a humbling process, you know, because, you know, you have to go through that spiritual humiliation process. He humbles you so that he can exalt you, you know what I mean? Because eventually it was already in his mind that he was going to, you know, restore him back to that pristine condition. But first comes the humiliation, which means he subjects the creature to vanity, he subjects you to all kinds of madness, and then he delivers you out of it.
Verse 21, it says, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of the Most High.
God. So, you know, ultimately, like I was saying, it was already in the mind of the Heavenly Father. It's already written. You know, we're just living it out. The Most High subjects us to depravity in order to, on the back end, deliver us out of it and put us in glorified bodies where we're completely righteous and not able to sin ever again. You know, it's beautiful. It's a thing that's glorious to see, man, because the Heavenly Father, there's no unequalness in him.
It's the book of Tobit. Tobit 3 in verse 4, it says, but they obey not thy commandments. Therefore thou hast delivered us for a spoil, and into captivity, and into death, and for a proverb of reproach, and to all the nations among whom we are dispersed.
Yeah, so you see that? That's that part of that process. That's that gauntlet of tribulation. You know what I mean? Now, once again, that's showing the gauntlet of tribulation that the Heavenly Father puts us through. It says a proverb of reproach. It says a byword. Salaki, what else does it say?
It says for a spoil. It says and unto captivity and unto death.
Spoil. You know, you're going to be always spoiled. The scripture says that in Deuteronomy. It talks about always spoiled. It says captivity. You know, for captivity. You know, you're going to go into captivity. You know what I mean? You're going to be under rulership of other people. You know, you're going to have to experience that. I want you to sit there, and I want you to experience being in captivity, where things don't go your way. You know what I mean? That humiliation process. You know, this is so you can be, you know, received. You know, received back into, you know, made clean and received, you know, back to the Heavenly Father, man. You know, to be presented as a glorious church. You know, clothed in righteousness.
Jonah 2 and 8, they that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy. It says they that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy.
Yeah, so that was going into what the brother Karafan brought out in Romans 8 and 20 about how Yahweh Shemashah made the creature subject unto vanity. But we are to overcome that vanity by the process of humiliation, because a part of infirmities is bearing afflictions and adversities or not being to fulfill your own corrupt desires. That's a part of an infirmity. So those whom are humiliated in the process of not being able to fulfill the desires of their flesh and bearing those infirmities, okay, these are the ones who are gonna obtain mercy. But those who continue to observe the vanity that Yahweh Bashimash made a subject unto, they're not gonna receive mercy, you know? Just to add that.
Prophet Jeremiah chapter 24 and verse 9. It says, and I will deliver them to be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth for their hurt, to be a reproach and a proverb, a taunt and a curse in all places whither I shall drive them.
Yeah, and that's a major blow, man. You know, considering that the Most High said, I'll make you the head and not the tail. You know, I'll make you above and not believe you'll lend. You know, and not borrow, that's a major blow, you know? You know, that's a major step down, you know? You know, that's completely humbling, you know what I mean? You're an enemy and one of all things, you know? That's humiliating, man, you know? For you not to be able to enjoy, you know, the simple things in life, you know? It's super humiliating, you know? But it's all getting us somewhere, you know? That's the point. You know, it's a greater purpose in mind. Most High has a method to madness. You know, it may seem mad, it may seem like madness to us, but it's a method. It's a method too. You know, sometimes Jake's, you know, they'll walk up and they'll ask, man, why are we in certain positions? Like, why are we in this position? Why are we in such a low, downtrodden position? You know, this is pleasing in the sight of the Heavenly Father to do this.
This is the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 57, verse 15. For thus said the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in the high and holy place, with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble, and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. Says, for thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity.
Yeah, the high and lofty one is, of course, that's Yahweh.
It says, whose name is holy, I dwell in the high and holy place with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit.
Yeah, because the Most High has respect unto the lowly.
To revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite one.
Yeah, so he revives the heart of the humble and the contrite ones. You know, why would he have to revive them? Because they were in a dead state, you know? They were in the congregation of the dead. He had to revive them, you know? The valley of the dry bones, so to speak. You know what I mean?
This is the book of Psalms, chapter 34, verse 18. The Lord Yahweh is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. It says, the Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and save of such as be of a contrite spirit.
Save of such as be of a contrite spirit. You know, that's what the Most High, he saves, you know what I mean? How you doing, sister? Yeah, so he saves such as be of a contrite spirit. But how do you become a contrite person? Usually the Most High has to bring you through a series of events. He has to put you through the ringer. Because, you know, your people are